presence
of a holy God.
Several of our friends are stranded in a very heavy traffic. So we will pray that God will continue to bless all those who are coming. We do understand always there are stumbling blocks, but God is greater and more powerful than any force in this world. And we have to submit ourselves to the sovereignty of God. This afternoon, even before we begin our program, it is my very sincere desire and earning from my heart that by God's grace, we will begin this with prayer. So even before we begin this session, shall we all reverently, wherever you are, I want to request that all of you bow your heads. We are going to give 5 minutes. And during this 5 minutes, we want to pour our heart to God. Keep walking in. There's another church that has just arrived. Welcome, people of God. You're most welcome. Please come. Please do come. We will be happy if you all walk up right to the front. Please don't sit at the back, please. Keep walking up to the front, please. There are about 20, 30 people walking in. Thank you. Can I request the volunteers to kindly seat them all right here in the front? We will go occupying from front to back. Thank you. Thank you, people of God. Thank you. Thank you so very much. Very orderly and very, very organized group. We appreciate that. To begin our service, shall we all stand wherever we are? Wherever we are. We're going to spend some time in prayer. Let's close our eyes. The Bible says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. This is the time for us to confess our sins. Even before we begin this fasting and prayer, we are going to ask God to bless us. Confess my sins. I want to very specially pray for the following areas. Maybe you are so hurting, you are deeply wounded in your heart because someone has hurt you intentionally through their act or through their words or probably through their attitudes. You have been so hurt. You know you were not wrong. Certainly you know for sure and for a fact that you are innocent, but you've been victimized. And that has bothered you. It has really handicapped your spirituality. Will you please take some time to forgive that person who has hurt you the most in your life? I want you to specially pray for that person who has damaged your peace, your joy. Maybe in the house, in the workplace, maybe a friend or a relative or even an enemy. Let's humble ourselves and say, Lord, I know that such and such a person has hurt me, but I'm not going to allow any of these emotions or situations to overtake me. I choose to forgive. I choose to let go. I choose to allow God to take over. Say that prayer, friends, for sure God will give you great peace. Amen. Our last prayer is that I want each of you to think about one person in your life. One person whom you know has not accepted the truth. Throughout this day, you are going to pray for that one person, or maybe one barangay, or one family. Whatever the Spirit of God impresses you, we are all going to, maybe he's your fruit vendor, or maybe he's your newspaper boy, maybe he's a pizza boy delivery boy, or maybe he is your spouse, or she is your relative. One person or one family that needs to be saved. Remember that family right now. Let's pray to God. Lord, we want to remember this person. We want to pray for the salvation. I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit will work so effectively and efficiently that there will be amazing results. Father, we glorify. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated, please. You may be seated. Now we are going to have praise and worship. We want all of you to join with the team that will be here up front here, and as they lead out in singing, it is my desire and my prayer that you will join with everyone in singing. Praise God, praise God. People are coming. I see about 20, 30 people walking in. Shall we say praise God? Praise God. Let's pray that God will remove the traffic. God will remove all the hurdles. Praise team, are you ready? We are waiting for you. Praise God. Praise God. The praise team has arrived. Hold it in your hand, please. You can stand right in the middle and put it right in the middle of the stage. Right in the center of the stage.
Good afternoon, everyone, and happy Sabbath. We praise the Lord for this time that we can have prayer and fasting. And in the Bible, we are given a promise. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, it says there, "If my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, and I will hear from heaven and forgive their sins and heal their land." And so this afternoon we'll be singing the Bible again, and I believe some of the songs that you'll be singing have been taught before, so we're just gonna review those songs. And it's written in Psalms 119:11. It says there, do you know that verse? Psalm 119:11, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee," against the Lord. And that's the main reason why we are going to sing the scriptures. So the scriptures will be in our hearts and you will not sin against the Lord. And so please open your Bibles to 2 Chronicles 7:14. 2 Chronicles 7:14. And let us all together sing this verse. If my people, are you all there? Can you please say amen if you're there?
Amen.
Amen. So let's sing. If my people.
Amen.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin and heal their land. If my people, to follow us? Okay, let's try all together. Can you please join us and open your Bibles? We're singing the King James Version po. So if you have King James, that's the word that we are using. So let's try once more.
If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray.
Scripture song, this is a little bit easier and a little bit shorter. Please open your Bibles to John 14:14. And if you want to record the song so you'll not forget and you can recall it, po, you can record it through your phone so that as this program will end, we can still continue to sing these songs. So please open your Bibles to John 14:14. And it says there, if you shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Amen. The Lord has promised us that if we will ask anything according to His name, according to His will, He will do it for us. And then we'll just add a few lines, po. Just according to my holy name, I will do it. I will do it just according to my holy name. So we'll sing it first, and I hope you listen, and then we'll all together sing this verse. So please join us once more and let us all together sing John 14:14. Please sing with us.
If you shall ask anything in my name, just according to my holy name, I will do it. I will do it just according to my holy name.
Let's repeat.
If you shall ask
for the last time, we'll be requesting just all of you, we'll not be joining you, just all of you to sing John 14:14. This is quiz time, and so you will sing John 14:14.
Sing. If you
You learn very fast. Praise God. And so for our last scripture song, we'll be singing Psalm 119, verse 11. The verse that I mentioned a while ago, Psalm 119, verse 11. It's very easy to memorize this verse, and it says there, "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." Can we recite all together? Thy word, ready, start. "Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee." Okay, let's sing.
Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. That I might not sin, that I might not sin. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee.
Get the tune, po? It's easy? Yes. Amen. So let's try to sing it all together. Thy word. Sing.
Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not sin against thee. In my heart, that I might not sin against thee. That I might not sin, that I might not sin. Thy word have I hid in my heart. Psalm 119:11.
Hello. Good afternoon, brothers and sisters, and happy Sabbath to all. Okay, so from this moment in time, we will now have our united prayer. And we will be grouping ourselves by 3 to 5 persons. So we'll look for someone who you can group with. One group will be composed of 3 to 5 members. And we're going to do united prayer. So before I introduce to you about united prayer, sino na po bang naka-experience mag-united prayer? Who among you have tried to do united prayer? Okay. So most of us, wala pa naka-try ng united prayer. So, united prayer goes like this. Me and my brother will be the one who will lead us in our united prayer. And on our united prayer, we will have 4 seasons of prayer. How many seasons of prayer? 4. The first season of prayer is that we will lead the introductory prayer. So, after we will have the introductory prayer, among yourselves, you will start to pray randomly. Not with sequence, but randomly as the Holy Spirit will lead you. And then you can say your praises and thanksgiving unto God. And then after that, our sisters will lead us into singing. And then after the singing, we will proceed to another season of prayer. Then next season of prayer is called confession. So, in this season of prayer, our brother will lead us into the introductory prayer again. And then for the confession, it will be special. It will be not like the other confession of prayer, season of prayer. Because on confession, we will have a moment of silence. So, is that clear? Yes. For the second season of prayer, we will have a moment of silence. And then our sister will lead us to singing again. And we will proceed to the another season of prayer. So, bale, meron po tayong apat na seasons of prayer. First, adoration. Second po is confession. And third season of prayer po is supplication. So, again, I will lead the introductory prayer. And after po ng introductory prayer natin, all of us will pray randomly as the Holy Spirit will lead you. So, after po ng prayer na yun, supplication po, meaning we will present to God what we want to ask from Him. And after that season, which is the season of supplication, we'll have to the next, to the last part of our united prayer, which is the thanksgiving session. So, sa last po, all that we need to pray is our thanksgiving to God. So, there's no other prayer po, but just thanksgiving. We'll present our thanks to God about everything you want to think about po. So, shall we group now ourselves into 3 to 5? And then our sister will lead us into the united prayer. We'll singing and united prayer. So, shall we kneel down po as we pray?
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. Oh, because we do not carry everything to God in prayer.
Our most gracious, kind, and loving Heavenly Father, Lord, this moment, we would like to pray unitedly, Lord. And for this moment, Lord, we want to present to you our adoration. We want to give our adoration to you, Lord, for what you are and for that what you have done in our lives, Lord. And dear God, we praise you and we give you all the glory for this wonderful moment that we can pray. And Lord, we plead and pray that may you please hear your children praying, Lord.
praise you, dear God, that you will be teaching us how to pray. We praise you, dear God, for this moment that we can commune to you through prayer.
Yes, I praise you, dear God,
for
the
whiter than snow, yes, whiter than snow. Now wash me and I shall be whiter than snow.
Yes, O Father, as now we receive our praise. Father, now we want to ask you forgiveness. Father, you know us personally. Father, you know our hearts. Father, you know our minds. Please, without you, we are nothing. That's why, Father, we come to you with our weakness. We come to you. We hold this dirtiness in our hearts and our mind to ask forgiveness for our sins. Yes, as your daughters and sons are now humbling themselves, opening their hearts to show you what is inside, may you listen to our confessions, Father.
There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb.
Yes, indeed, dear loving Heavenly Father, Lord, there's power in the blood of the Lamb. And Lord, we would like to praise you, dear God, that we can come to you and ask for strength, Lord. For we know that life only comes from you. And Lord, as your children will present their needs, dear God, I pray that you will hear them, Lord.
You are in control of everything. And Lord, this moment we would like to plead and to beg, dear God, that may your Holy Spirit fill this room. And Lord, may your children and all of us, Lord, will feel your presence this very moment. And Lord, help us, Lord, that may this program may not just be another program for us, but it will be a start of our conversion, Lord, and more deeper walk with you. And I pray, Lord, that may this continually change us, Lord, to be in your own likeness.
We as your bride, we also know that the enemy might have come here uninvited. We beg you, Lord, in the name of Jesus and for your name's sake, may please cast out the devil and join me out of this hotel, join me out of this room, that no power will be hindered from bringing us after you.
May this contribute to the love of your Holy Spirit to change your life.
Oh yes, dear Lord, I believe that not everybody knows their nothingness right now and they need of you. So just as we dear Lord, may please show each person how nothing they are unless they we all invited you to come to
our lives. Lord, we know that it is not the participant, it is not the grandeur of the program, Lord, that makes revival in this place. Mm-hmm. But it's only through your Holy Spirit, Lord. And so, Lord, we beg and ask the Lord that you please pour upon us, Lord, your Holy Spirit.
Yes, your Lord, shake this whole building of the Holy Spirit, that all of us will feel in you.
Yes, Father, again, give up the Holy Spirit. Give up the Holy Spirit.
Holy Spirit of God, dwell in me and rule my life. Cast away every sin in my soul. Will you take a full control of my life and make me whole?
Also forgiving our sins and also accepting our supplications. Yes, Father, we thank you for your great goodness. We thank you for showing us our nothingness, Father. Yes, now, our God, once again, your children are going to give you thanksgiving. May you listen to them, Father.
Thank you for helping all those people who give the strength, the time for the organization of this program, Father. We thank you so much for your love for us. We thank you for the Holy Spirit that you gave us. We believe that, Father, the Holy Spirit is now here. Thank you for us, what you are going to do just in the few coming times.
Thank you. Praise you, dear God, that you are leading now and will lead in the rest for the rest of the program, Lord. Please be our captain, Lord, and please lead us, Lord, for we cannot do this without you. Thank you, Lord, for the promise that you will be with us and you will never leave us nor forsake us. I would like also to praise you, Lord, for Ate Miriam, that you have been so good to her, that you have been supplying her, and that you have been leading her, Lord, to grow more into you. I praise you, dear God, that you have raised one of the spiritual leaders in AUP, Lord. And I praise you, dear God, that you will raise more, Lord.
Yes, Lord, I agree with my sister and brother's prayer. And I want also to add also, thank you for all those people here today. Thank you also for all those our friends, our brothers, that we use by the inspiring life to change our life. We thank you so much, Lord.
Dear Lord, as Wendy's prayer, I just want to thank you for the promise in Philippians 1:6 that the very good work that you have started in us, you'll finish it. You'll faithfully finish it.
Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation.
We would like to praise you, Lord, for this wonderful prayer time. And Lord, all of these are humble requests. And we lift this up, Lord, in the name of Jesus Christ. Let all God's people say, Amen.
afternoon. Sorry. This program is entitled Total Member Involvement. Why did we choose this topic and what does it entail? What is it about? I have very prayerfully decided, and as I was preparing for this, the Spirit of the Lord impressed me that we should ask some members to come to the front, and we're going to ask them some very simple questions, and they will testify about how good the Lord has been and what it is for a member of the Adventist Church to be involved in evangelism. So I want to just very quickly invite the following. Can you please come to the front without further delay? Can I request Dr. Julie to kindly come forward, please? I would want him to come. Dr. DeCastro, can you please come forward? I want to request another couple, John and his wife Deng from Dasmaji Church. Will you please come quickly? I'm going to be interviewing several of them during this course of time. So during the first session, I would like to ask them from a very simple question, and we will see what the Spirit has to impress on our minds. The General Conference has adopted a plan. I want all of you to look here. From 2015 to 2020, that the 5 years, we will have a program called Reach the World. And it simply asks every member of the Adventist Church, every Seventh-day Adventist member will be involved in the mission of the church. Is there someone here who can raise your hand and tell me what is the mission of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Can someone say that? What is the mission of the Seventh-day Adventist Church? Yes, somebody? Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Shall we say amen to that elder? Elder, which church do you come from, Elder? Which church? I want to know the name of the church. Mendes. Okay, praise God. Thank you, Elder, for the beautiful answer. Can we have them quickly here? Please. We'll be happy if you can stand right at them, two of you on the other side, quickly. No. Here, sir. Can you hold this? Okay. I would like to ask the first question to Dr. Julie. Dr. Julie is at the far end. We would like to have all of you stand right in the middle. These are all Seventh-day Adventist members, and these are laity. Do you know who is a laity? Can someone tell me who is a laity? Who is a laity? Okay, who is a lay member? Can you tell me, please? Who is a lay member? Not lame member, lay member. Who is a lay member? Okay, maybe I will ask the first question to them. One of you, can you tell me, sir, who is a lay person? Who is a laity? Someone? Who?
Somebody is not the pastor, not a pastor.
Exactly. Someone who does not have a ministerial credential. He is not ordained into the ministry. I would like to ask the first question to Dr. Julie. Dr. Julie is an ENT. ENT. You know what is that? Yes. If you don't hear properly, you can meet him right after this consultation. Dr. Julie, I would like to ask you. You are married. You have a job. You are a doctor. God has blessed you well. Why would you want to even come and attend this meeting all the way from beyond Makati. What made you come here? You could have stayed there. You are not a pastor. You are not an elder of the church. What propels you? What brings you force to come and attend the meeting? Is there a reason?
Well, we always want to seek God's will in our lives. And we want to, in every event, we go to church, right? But we want to attend the meetings because we want to commit ourselves. We want to know more God's will in our lives. Amen. And primarily also we want to bring our families to be blessed and see the goodness of God in programs like this.
Thank you. I would like to take it to another level. Dr. DeCastro, I would like to ask you a question. You are a well-renowned physician. God has blessed you. You have a good house. You have a good family. God has blessed you with a good pay. I want to tell you, is that all life about? Is there something beyond your practice? Is there something beyond your profession? Is there something beyond your regular vocation? Is there something? Have you discovered it recently? Has the Lord revealed to you? Is there something more to life than being a doctor?
I always say this. Every time we encounter different types of people, and usually they will always ask why we're not doing this, why we're not doing that, and why we're going to church on Sabbath. And sometimes they invited you, where of course out of their ignorance they will tell you, can you go and attend our meeting on a Saturday? And if you're given that challenge, it's a difficult challenge actually, because if this is your first time, it's hard to do it always the first time. And in my experience, I always struggle with the first time. But the moment you start saying the right thing, it becomes easy the second time. Okay. So when somebody asks me, why can't you not come on a Saturday? Then I would have to tell them different reasons. And eventually I would tell them, because Sabbath is the Lord's Day. And there was an experience that I encountered when I was like confronted with my colleagues asking me really to do something on a Sabbath day. And I said, why did you put me on a Sabbath day? And so I have to say, I can't make it because it's the Lord's Day. I have to honor God on Sabbath day. And when he knew that I'm not coming on a Saturday, he said, you have faith. In other words, there are people who are just there and probably they don't know anything about it. And when they ask you, it will probably be your chance to tell them exactly why you do the things that you do. And when I told him that, you know, I only realized he's also a Christian. And he wanted to say the word with me. And so when I told him about it, and then he kept sending me through email Bible verses. Amen. I should be the one to start doing it. But I was surprised. He did it only because he realized that I'm a Christian. So you see, you missed opportunity when you see the wrong things. But when you see the right thing, God opens up a lot of opportunities. You'll just be surprised. Sometimes it's not always smooth to me.
Okay.
But there's a lot of struggles. But in that struggle, you have to really give up certain things. If you don't give it up, you know my personal experience, it, if I don't give it up, I will always end up in a mess. But the moment I give it up, it's like what Pastor Paul is saying, you remove the curse. Because when you say the right thing, then God, you will just be amazed. God will just bless you. I would use the word of Pastor, who's the PYC speaker before? From GC?
Jerry Page.
Yeah, no, Jerry, Page. Jerry Page. He would just crazily bless you. You would not know where it's coming from. But
Doctor, just but a quick follow-up question. I want you to answer this. Will you be embarrassed to share about Jesus with your patients? Or do you consider it as a privilege?
When I did it the first time, I'm really shy. Sort of shy. But the moment you keep doing it, it's like natural for you to do it. I would really understand if you've done it the first time, because it's hard. But the moment you open it up, I have a patient, and I didn't know he's an atheist. So when I treated him, and he's like, "Oh, my pain is gone." And I said, "Praise the Lord." You know, when I said the word "praise the Lord," he was like, "Doctor, I'm an atheist." I said, "What? You're an atheist?" And then I told him, "You know what? Probably you were brought here because God wants you to learn about God more." So before he left, we prayed. The next time when he came, "You know what, doctor?" he said, "My wife has been praying for me to go back to God because I became an atheist when I went to Europe. Now that I'm here, I told my wife, I met a man who told me about God. And when I told him about God, the next time around he was saying, my wife was just so happy that I told him about God and that he came back to God. And that was actually a chance for him to get back to God. And the next time around, he was already very happy. He was like, I'm reading my Bibles already. I'm going back to God." You know, he's not an Adventist, but I could say he went back to God. And to me, it doesn't have to be an Adventist. It has to be our witness for that kind of people. You know, we don't know what's going to happen after that. But the point is, at least we are instrumental in telling them about Jesus. I'm embarrassed, I would say, the first time.
Okay.
But the next time around, it becomes easy.
Last question. I've known this couple. This is an architect couple. They stay in Dasmaji. I have seen them involved very heavily doing dental missions. Sometimes they travel all the way to Ilocos. They travel to Light. Many times traveling for ministerial trips. I want to ask a question to this couple, and I want you to briefly answer me. Why would you take the trouble to do all this apart from your regular vocation? What makes you do that?
First, because of the overwhelming truth and faithfulness, maybe.
Amen.
Because sometimes I ask God, "God, why do you do this to us?" Mm-hmm. I mean, all the strength. You can just imagine the tired body that we have every time we do that. But it's always the feeling of being blessed and the faithfulness of Christ that is always upon us. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I ask myself, why are you so faithful? Because most of the time we are not. And then I just wonder, and I am just in awe to really want to share how God is gracing and how He is blessing the family. And the way we see things, I mean, after 5 years of just being an SDA, it just overwhelms us that we could not contain ourselves in the church only, that we find this need to go out and fellowship with other brethren and non-brethren also. So that's some kind of fulfillment to us to be able to serve God the way that we do it.
Okay. Elder John, why would you do what you are doing? What makes you do that, sir?
She says it only.
Okay.
Now, for me, po, by God's grace, po, I know, time will come. All of this, whatever we are doing, we're not going to do it anymore. We are there, we are commissioned, we are there to teach, to
Amen.
Preach.
Amen.
So that's why we go with pastor or wherever there is a chance that there's a fellowship. We need to be equipped. Every one of us. It's not just the pastors. It's not just our lay leaders, you know. Not that our doctors here, you know. Time will come. They will stop. We have to equip ourselves. So we have to attend. We have to fellowship. We need to learn.
Okay. My last question.
Okay.
I want each of you to answer only very briefly one line. Exactly one line. Why should we share about Jesus and the truth that we have? What is the need? Doc Julie, why should we share about Jesus?
Jesus commanded us to share. And if we have something that's good, we're being selfish if we don't share to other people for their salvation as well.
Amen. I want you to look at this. Jesus told that every member, whether you're a boy or a girl, university student, married, old, retired, except when you're in the womb, if you have been born in this world, you must do. Doctor, why should we share? What is the rationale?
Personally, I feel it may be the last chance for me to tell
God
about Jesus. So the second chance might not happen.
Okay. Ma'am, why should we share about Jesus? Why?
Because that's our role in the world. I mean, the day God that we were born, we should know about Jesus and we should share about him. Because okay, if we're not, then our life is in vain.
Praise God. Elder John, what is the need for us to share?
For me po, it's the salvation of Jesus Christ. We need the people, the world to know that Jesus is the only Savior.
Thank you. Shall we say amen for these testimonies? That is a live testimony. Thank you so very much for joining us. Every member, I want all of you to be inspired. Derive inspiration today. You don't simply go to class. You don't simply work. Oh, thank you so much. I was not sure what's happening. Okay. Finally, we are going to say something. If you have learned something new, and if you know that your neighbor knows nothing, it's your moral obligation. So we have three sessions this afternoon. We are going to get into the first session. Our first session will be the study of God's Word. So we are going to study. Before that, I'm going to invite my friends to come to the stage, and we're going to have a song. Can we have this projector on? Today we have a very special guest with us. I would like to invite her, and want to invite Jessamine. Is the guitar there? Where is the guitar? Did we see a guitar somewhere here to the left side or? Was it at the end or? Okay, thank you.
Shanti deta hai
ek ma ki tarah prabhu shanti deta hai
sene se lagayega sankat sab mitayega sene se lagayega संकट सब मिटाएगा एक माँ की तरह प्रभु शांति देता है एक माँ की तरह प्रभु शांति देता है कभी ना छोड़ेगा कभी ना त्यागेगा kabhi na chhodega, kabhi na tyagega, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti deta hai, aansu sab pochega, man ki chinta mitayega, aansu sab pochega, man ki chinta mitayega, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti deta hai. Prabhu shanti deta hai.
Sine se lagayega, sankat sab mitayega.
Sine se lagayega, sankat sab mitayega. Ek maa ki tarah. Prabhu shanti deta hai.
I think we are going to ask all of you to sing this Indian song. We'll just go one more time quickly, very simple, and this is what it means. You see the meaning of this song. So let's turn this side and we will all try to glorify God. Just join us in singing this song. Praise the Lord. Everybody. Join us.
Kitara Prabhu Shanti Deta Hai.
That's the way.
Ek Ma Kitara Prabhu Shanti Deta Hai. Kabhi Na Chodega, Kabhi Na Tyagega, Kabhi Na chodega, kabhi na tyagega, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti.
Very good.
Aansu sab pochega, man ki chinta mitayega, aansu sab pochega, man ki chinta mitayega, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti deta hai.
Last one.
Sine se lagayega, sankat sab mitayega, sine se lagayega, sankat sab mitayega, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti treta hai, ek maa ki tarah, prabhu shanti deta hai.
Thank you so much. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Thank you. Thank you, my Indian friend. Thank you, my Visayan friend. Thank you for joining us. Let's listen to what God has to teach to us this evening. Could you kindly put this down? Thank you so much. I want to let you know we arranged 400 chairs and now the hall is overflowing. We may not have place anymore and more people are coming in. Praise the Lord. The capacity is now being overflowed. We will be very happy. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we come to you in Jesus' name. We want to discover your will for us. Would you please speak to us? We from the Central Luzon Conference, particularly in Tagaytay City, want to have total member involvement, where every Seventh-day Adventist member, elder, deacon, deaconesses, all the children, university students, pastors, conference leaders, all of us would like to be having total member involvement. And as we do this, Lord, we need your spirit, we need your power. As we look at one of the most interesting stories, help us what it is to have total member involvement. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you have brought your Bibles, will you please quickly open your Bibles and quickly come with me to 1 Kings chapter 18. 1 Kings chapter 18. Let's look at this. And the hand of the Lord was on Elijah, and he girded up his loins, and he ran before Ahab to the entrance of Jezreel. I want you to look at total member involvement. In 1 Kings chapter 18, there is a story. The story is simple and fabulous. On Mount Carmel, Elijah is all alone, and he is fighting and is being challenged by 450 prophets of Baal plus 400. 450 plus 400, 850 prophets. And they say, come, let's have a challenge. We're going to pray, and whoever sends fire from heaven, we will acknowledge and concede, okay, you are the victor, we are the losers. All the 850 prophets, 450 plus 400, and on the other hand, they had only one pastor. No member, no church board, only one pastor. One pastor versus the world. No total member involvement. Listen to this amazing story. As they had this wonderful story going ahead, I want you to look here. And Ahab told Jezebel. Do you know who is Jezebel? Jezebel is Ahab's wife. Was she a good person? She was a wicked person. I want you to know. You know the story? Many hours, those 850 people prayed and prayed. No answer, no reply, no fire from heaven. But Elijah prayed. As he prayed, did the Lord send fire? As we are praying here for Tagaytay City, gathering here as members, do you think God is going to send the fire of the Holy Spirit? Yes? But how many pastors prayed for fire? Only one. This afternoon, not one, but total member involvement. I want you to know what happened in 1 Kings chapter 18, victory. But what's happening here? Let's go here. Ahab told Jezebel all that. This is the problem. Who had done? Elijah. Was it Elijah who brought fire from heaven? Yes or no? It was God who brought. Where is God in the equation? Pastors have to be very careful in their ministry. Pastors can pray, pastors can preach, but God brings the result. And the moment Elijah takes credit, I want you to see. 1 Kings chapter 18, Elijah is at the top of the mountain. 1 Kings chapter 18, Elijah is all alone, challenging 850 prophets. But in 1 Kings chapter 19, he is afraid of one lady and is running for life. You have to be careful of one dangerous lady in this world. I'm not talking about your wife. No, I know all of you have good wife. The Bible is clear. One lady threatened his life. What happened? In the previous chapter, he stood like a king for a long time bringing fire from heaven. But here, it is so unfortunate that he's running. What happened to him? Let's continue the story. Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, so let the gods do to me, and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. Jezebel said, in 24 hours, sorry to say, you will be killed. Listen to this word of God, please. 24 hours time, Elijah would be slain. 24 hours time, Elijah would be killed. How will you feel that you are given only 24 hours? One doctor came to a patient in a hospital room and he said, my patient, I have one bad news and I have one worse news for you. And the patient was so sad. He said, what could be the most bad and worst news? And say, said, okay, doctor told the patient, do you want me to tell you the bad news or the worst news? He said, please tell me the bad news first. What was the bad news? The doctor told the patient, you have only 24 hours to live. And the patient said, what else could be more worse than this? Doctor, what is the worst news? I forgot to tell you this yesterday. He had only 24 hours to live, but the doctor forgot to inform. Friends, some of us are in the same spiritual condition. We have only 24 hours to live, and some of us are not telling our neighbors. If your neighbor in your barangay, in your subdivision, dies in the next 24 hours without knowing, that is your responsibility. If the doctors diagnose the disease and if they don't tell you, the doctors can be sued. You better be a spiritual doctor. Let's go here. Tomorrow you will lose your life. Let's continue here. And when he saw that, he arose and went for his life and he came to Beersheba. Even the most powerful pastor, powerful preacher could go through such valley of depression. He is now running out of fear and he did not receive the word of God. Every time he listened to God's word, God said, go to the wilderness, go to Brook Cherith. He went. God told him, the word of the Lord came, go to the widow at Zarephath. And the word of the Lord came to him, go to Mount Carmel. But this time the word of God did not come. You have to be careful when you listen to God's voice. Let's pray here. The Bible is clear. He went to Judah. And what did he do? He left his servant there. How many of you have left your servants who are supposed to be in your church and came to Summit Ridge? Let's continue the story. Why did he go? Fear. And he said, Lord, look at the total member involvement. I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts because the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altar, and slain thy prophets with the sword. And I, please read it with me, I, even I only am left. How many were left? Was he telling the truth or was he lying? Was he exaggerating? Yes or no? Do you think Elijah was the only man who was left? I'm going to show you total member involvement. Listen to what God says. Yet I have left Elijah. Hey, you pastor, don't take pride in saying you're the only evangelist. You're the only preacher. He says, I only am left. Elijah did not have any address. The moment God used him to bring fire, Elijah started printing a business card. You know, he became very proud and he said, I am the only one. Don't ever think like that. Let's go to the Bible. I want you to tell me how many members did God have in total member involvement? How many? How many? Can you look at the answer and tell me, please? 7,000 in Israel. All the knees which have not bowed unto Baal and every mouth which has not kissed Baal. I want you to know. How many did God have for total member involvement. How many did God have? 7,000. How many pastor was there at that time? One. But did that pastor involve total member involvement? Yes or no? Whose problem was it? The pastor's problem. Imagine if only Pastor Ray. I want Pastor Ray to stand up. This is your district pastor. Pastor, can you stand, please? Shall we say amen? Amen. Pastor, keep standing, keep standing. Let people see your wonderful face. Pastor Ray, do you think he can go to all these Tagaytay and preach? I will ask him some questions. Pastor, how many churches do you have in your district? 7. Pastor, how many members? I like that question. Okay, tell me about the active members. 400 to 500. Thank you, Pastor. Praise God. Let's look at what's happening here. Please come with me. But he went into a day's journey. He goes right to the wilderness. And he comes and sits under a juniper tree. And he said, Lord, I want to die. I'm a pastor. This is my 18th year. Many times I've prayed this prayer. Lord, I am very tired. The way my church board persecutes me, the way I have to handle some members, Lord, let me die. But if he wanted to die, why did he run from Jezebel? He could have stayed there. In other words, this man is not an honest man. He didn't want to die. If he were an honest man, he should have stayed there and Jezebel would have come and said, hey, you die. He ran from Jezebel because he didn't want to die, but now he says, I want to die. Not all what pastors say are true. There may be some good people like me, so don't worry about it. Let's go here. And he said, it is, look at the next one. What does this pastor say? It is enough. Take away my life. He requested to God. He sent an email. He texted and said, Lord, I want to die. And he was in the juniper tree. Friends, look at something. Pastors have stress. Pastors have burnout. Do you know that? Do you know what it is for one pastor to pastor 7 churches? Go ahead. And if pastors, we think that the department directors have no stress, you go and sit with them. And if you go and sit with the department directors, they will say how stressful it is. Everybody is stressed. One man cannot do this evangelism. Let's continue the story. And as he lay and slept under a juniper tree, sometimes you have to come away from your church and gather in Summit Ridge. My friend, myself, we came here. God put a special burden in some of our hearts. I've been a student in IS doing missions. We are studying Hebrew and Greek, and God spoke to me. What are you doing as students of mission to preach about me? I want you to go and tell about me in Tagaytay. I said, Lord, I don't have the money. I don't know anybody. I don't speak the language. God said, go. One day, I want to tell you the truth. I walked all the way from Rotunda, all the way here, walked. And as I walked, I looked at left side, right side. Lord, where can we gather our members? I know all the hotels and how much do they charge. I want to tell you, my friends, this hotel, I'm saying this, I hope there is nobody listening here. Okay, you can continue to be busy, not just doing something. If you have to hire this place for a marriage hall, you will pay 3 times. This is fully AC. This is a 3-star hotel. They have given us this place only for 15,000 pesos. Amen? When you have a heart, God will pay for it. Amen? Now I struck the deal, 15,000, with faith. And God spoke to me. And he revealed to me, don't worry about money. I have already prepared one person from Pasai Church. All you have to do is go contact him. I contacted him and he issued a check. Shall we say praise the Lord? Yes. And I have the faith, even for next meeting, he will continue to give. I know that for sure. Shall we say amen?
Amen.
Everybody is saying amen except him. It's okay. Now let's say that. Now the Bible is clear. This man was sleeping under a juniper tree. Friends, sleep is a gift from God. Amen.
Amen.
You cannot sleep unless God gives you sleep. Do you agree with me? Yes. Let's continue. And angel touched him and said unto him, look at this, total member involvement, arise and eat. How many of you came to Summit Ridge for eating? We are going to eat something, and I'm going to tell you what this meeting will do in your life today. Are you ready? An angel touched him and said unto him, arise and eat. What to eat? Let's look at the Bible. And the angel of the Lord came again and said the second time, touched him and said, arise and eat, because the journey is too great for you. You have to eat the word of God today. Do you know how many meals did Elijah eat under the juniper tree? How many meals? Tell me. Anybody who tells the right answer will get 1,000 pesos. I'm being very honest. Not from me, but from Pastor Ben Casimiro, your CLC president. Okay, I'm very happy Pastor Casimiro is here. He's waiting with 1,000. How many meals did he eat? Only one. One meal. One meal. Do you know how many days he walked and fasted after this? How many? Let's go to the Bible. And the angel of the Lord came second time. The journey is too great. And he arose and did eat and drink. He had only one meal. Members, please listen to God's word. How many meals did Elijah have? How many? One. Who told you you have to eat three times a day? That's not good. One meal is enough, sometimes two meals best. The Bible says, and he went in the strength of that. Is that singular or plural? Singular. Of that meat, that meal, 40 days and 40 nights unto Horeb, the mountain of God. Let's stop here. How many days did Elijah fast and pray? How many? How many days did Moses fast and pray? You have to be very careful when you say 40 days. How many days did Moses fast? Those of you who say 40 days, you go and dig your Bible. How many days did the children in Nineveh fast and pray? Don't tell me 40. How many days? How many days? 3 days. How many days did Jesus fast? The point is very simple. Look at the power of fasting in his life. He went in the strength of that meat 40 days and 40 nights. He did not eat anything for 40 days. Shall we say amen? And reaching a city like Tagaytay. If you are going to eat in Tagaytay so nicely, and every time you come to Tagaytay, you eat, do you think you and I can reach these people? You have to stop eating in the restaurant for some time. And you have to fast and pray and say, Lord, give me Tagaytay. Give me souls. One pastor cannot do this job. God has 7,000, and God wants to have total member involvement. Let's say, and he came thither unto a cave, and he lodged there, and behold, look at this, the word of the Lord came unto him, and he said unto him, what doest thou here, Elijah? Elder, you were nominated by the church board
not to do anything, but to be involved in missions. What doest thou here, elder in your church? Young man, do you think you came here by accident? What do you do in a nightclub, in a music entertainment, in a karaoke, when you're supposed to be in the church of God? What doest thou here, young man? Those of you who are not married, and you know that you are not in a proper relationship, what doest thou here, Elijah, in a room when you're not married? What doest thou here, you housewife, when you're supposed to read the Bible and pray and pray and tell your neighbors about Jesus? What doest thou here, Elijah? Elijah, I did not call you here to be in the cave. Elijah, I did not commission you that you will come out to Judah and be in Beersheba. Friends, this afternoon God is giving you a challenge. What doest thou here in Cavite? Do you think you are just happy working, earning, having your house and God's blessings? What doest thou here? Let us see how God changed this man from running away from mission, bringing him back, focusing him. Let's go to the Bible. And he said, Lord, I have been very jealous for the Lord. The children of Israel have forsaken. Instead of he being very honest and telling God, Lord, I was afraid of Jezebel, he's now shifting the blame and putting the blame wrongly on the people. Lord, I am the only one faithful. I'm the only one honest. I've forsaken the covenant. They've forsaken the covenant. Thrown down thine altar. They've slain the prophets. I alone am left. I want you to look at the transition. As God looked at this, God said, okay, you're in Tagaytay for a long time. You simply go to church every Saturday and you come back home and then you go back next Sabbath. Is this what I called you to do? Look at total member involvement. Let's go to God's word. God said, go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. I want you all to come to this beautiful mountaintop of Tagaytay. God says, this is God speaking to you, stand upon mount before the Lord. This evening and this afternoon, we are all going to stand right here in Summit Ridge before the Lord. And you know what is the good news? The Lord passed by. God is going to pass by Tagaytay. He's going to pass by Crossing Mendes. He's going to pass by Amadayo. He's going to cross by Rotanda. He's going to pass by Cavite. He's going to pass by CLC. He's going to pass by IAS. He's going to pass by AUP. But let us see how God will manifest himself. What doest thou here, Elijah? Don't you know that I have called you not to just be called as a pastor? You need to be involved and you need to work with 7,000 members. Let's look at how God manifests himself. Behold, the Lord passed by. Look at this. A great and strong wind rent the mountains. But do you think God was there? And break in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But was the Lord there? Yes or no? The Lord was not in the wind. Let's continue. And after the wind, an earthquake, but the Lord was not in the earthquake. Strong wind will come here in Tagaytay. What is that? You will have some terrific meetings there. You will have some great preachings there. Maybe you're thinking, oh, this is great music. God will not be there. Let's continue here. And after the earthquake was a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. Let's go to the first one. Great, great wind, mighty preachers. Maybe you're thinking, oh, we're going to see God. There's no God. And after that, earthquaking events. No God. and after that, fire, and after the fire, a still small voice. This afternoon, I want you to look and listen and fine-tune to the still small voice. What is the voice? And it was so, when Elijah heard it, he knew God came. He wrapped his face in the mantle and went out, and he stood in the entering of the cave, and behold, a voice came unto him. What doest thou here, Elijah? God is not going to come with mighty preaching, with great music. All of us have been hiding in the caves like Elijah. Instead of being in missions, evangelism, sharing about God, we are in the cave. We have been in Beersheba, and the worst thing is that we are looking for mighty things. Maybe you were so happy seeing the mighty wind, but God was not there. Maybe you were happy with an earthquake, but God was not there. Maybe you saw fire, but God was not there. This afternoon, God is speaking in a still small voice. What doest thou here, Elijah? I want to close with this. And the Lord said unto him, please look here, we want to close with this. Go! Maybe all these years you didn't do evangelism. Maybe all these years God gave you blessings. He gave you privileges. He blessed you with special prerogatives. But you were in the cave. You were in Beersheba. You were in Judah while you're supposed to be on the other side. You know why did God really call him? I want to ask you a question as we close. How many people did God tell Elijah to anoint? Right on the mountain. Can you tell me? How many people? Those of you who know the Bibles, we're going to close quickly. We have two more sessions. How many people did God choose to anoint through Elijah after this incident? Not one. Two? No. Three. Let's go to the Bible. Go. Return on thy way to the wilderness of Damascus. Anoint Hazael to be king over Syria. This afternoon, God is anointing you that you will go and anoint some people before they die. What is the name of the first person that you're supposed to anoint? Hazael. Number two, anoint another one. What's his name? Jehu. And finally, God told him, you have to go and anoint another one. What's his name? Elisha. Elijah, you've been thinking that you are the only pastor. You are the only preacher. No. Now I'm going to ask you to anoint three more people. And look at this. He shall be anointed to be prophet in thy room. I've used you in Mount Carmel. Praise God. I used you to bring fire from heaven. Now your ministry is over. Please get ready. Do you know why, friends? Elijah worked so tirelessly for God. He went almost to all the places. God said, the only place that you have not been is heaven, so I'm taking you. All those who do evangelism effectively, God will take you to heaven when he comes the second time. Amen? I don't want to be found here in Tagaytay forever, even after second coming, because this is not our place. I want to ask you a question. Out of the three people he anointed, two did not have good record. Hazael and Jehu were unconverted until they died. Not all the people in Tagaytay are going to be saved. Do you know that? not all the people are going to respond to the gospel call, but it is your responsibility to go and anoint. Do you know what happened because he anointed Elisha? Elisha was used so mightily. God can use one of you not to win 100 people. He can use you to just anoint one person, and that one person can bring one whole subdivision to Jesus. Amen? This evening, the message is simple. What doest thou here, Elijah? Are you in the center of God's will? Are you following God's mandate? Are you obedient to his commission? Are you listening to the still small voice? I have asked one of the group to come forward and sing a song. And as they're singing this song, I want all of you to take a decision for God. What doest thou here? You have no other mission in this world except to go and anoint people in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen? I want all of you to listen to the still small voice. The 7,000 people, their names are not prominent in the Bible. Their names are not even mentioned. Only Elijah's name is mentioned. None of the members were mentioned, but God had total member involvement. I want to tell you, you may not be an ordained pastor. You may not be an ordained elder, but God is anointing you with his Holy Spirit to be involved, that you will go and do missions from today in Tagaytay to reach the souls for Jesus. Amen. God bless you. God bless you.